Hello, and welcome to Amazing Mind, the hypnosis TV talk show that introduces you to all sorts of interesting people and topics related to subconscious behavior. My name is Lisa Mackenberg, hypnotherapist, HMI instructor, and host. Today we have an amazing guest. We have Dr. Stephen Grifka, MD. Now, Dr. Steve is a facial constructive plastic surgeon, and he also lectures at UC Riverside Medical School. And today, Dr. Grifka is going to talk to us about traumatic brain injury. Please help me welcome my guest. Thank you so much for being on the show.
My pleasure.
Can you tell us, what is traumatic brain injury?
Traumatic brain injury is an injury to our brain, as it says. Any type of injury. It could be if we're walking along and we get hit and our brain actually smashes into our skull. There are also several different levels of it, which we can discuss in a moment or two.
So are you saying that you don't need to get whacked in the head, fall on your head, get tackled on your head, and actually have trauma to the head to get a traumatic brain injury?
That's absolutely true. In fact, between 60 and 80% of whiplash injuries where we don't hit our head, we just have that sudden movement, end up in a traumatic brain injury. Any sudden change in the speed of your brain as compared to the rest of your body can cause this to happen because there's little blood vessels in the brain that supply nutrients to the brain and they can get ruptured and cause an injury.
So what would be the symptoms, and take me through severe, moderate, and mild?
Well, in a severe traumatic brain injury, you can have very big problems. You may not be able to breathe. You may be in a coma. That's easy to diagnose. The harder ones are the moderate or mild. Mild is oftentimes missed. Symptoms there can be anything from loss of memory, commonly headaches, loss of balance. You could have problems with ringing in the ears, anything like that. Problems finding a word in a sentence can also be a problem.
That seems really difficult because I know, like, for high blood pressure, you can measure it. For things like ADD, you have to just take a look at it symptomatically. How would moderate and even mild traumatic brain injury, how is it diagnosed? Just symptomatically?
Well, it is a very difficult diagnosis, and that's why it's missed very frequently. It's missed in emergency rooms. It's missed on battlefields. But the way that we do it is a very careful history. We ask all of those questions. And then we do an examination, and we try and pick up any loss of balance on examination. Following that, there is now, and actually I'm happy to say a colleague of mine and myself, Dr. McKenzie, have been working on an objective test. And it's
really
a subset of a bigger test, a balance test, called a VNG. I won't go into the whole word, but it's called a VNG. Specific subsets of that test show up as abnormal in traumatic brain injury. And so now when we see that, we can go, oh, this person probably has a traumatic brain injury. And even if they haven't told us about it, if we go back and ask them, it's been consistent that they will then say, well, actually, you know what, I fell down the other day, or things like that.
This is very interesting and very important for hypnotherapists and anyone in the mental health field or in any kind of medicine. Because, you know, especially as hypnotherapists, we have people coming in and saying, you know, I'm just having trouble concentrating. You know, I just can't find a word in a sentence. You know, I'm just not feeling myself. And we look for the psychological reasons, something in the subconscious mind. We might suspect post-traumatic stress disorder. But if someone comes in with that set of symptoms, what questions should we ask to see if they need a referral to find out if it is traumatic brain injury?
Well, the set of symptoms that we discussed, loss of memory, difficulty finding a word, loss of balance, headaches, very common, along with a history of having gotten, as we used to say, gotten their bell rung. You don't have to get knocked out, but you know, if you are in a car accident and you're dazed, there's a good likelihood that while your car got hit, your body moved and then stopped, your head moved and then stopped, but your brain is sitting in a gel inside of your skull. And it doesn't stop so quickly because it's in that liquid. And it can hit the side of your head, which is hard, or it can tilt and rip the little blood vessel. So those are all picked up with symptoms when we talk to people. And when you get suspicious of that, they probably should be referred for this balance testing. And I'm sorry, but an MRI scan, usually we'll miss it because it's
really?
It's not a big physical problem. It's not a big tumor in the brain, things like that. And so just on a neuron to neuron basis in the brain, you can't see it with most MRIs.
Wow. Are there treatments for this?
There are. There are people try medications, but most of them don't work all
the
that well.
Medications don't work. So what do we use?
Well, there's something called vestibular rehabilitative therapy.
Everybody do that, right? What is vestibular rehabilitation therapy?
We call it VRT because we're challenged. Mm-hmm. But when we do VRT, it is a form of physical therapy, a very specific form. Not all physical therapists know how to do it. And it's a set of exercises to either retrain the brain that's been injured or to train alternate pathways within our brain, because there's a lot of the brain we don't use. So
yes,
we do have this plasticity in the brain that allows us to retrain alternate routes to cover for areas that were damaged.
So there's a damaged area and we can actually return function by creating new neural pathways, kind of like with a Macintosh, a workaround.
Exactly.
Yes. What are some of these exercises? What would they be like? Are they hard?
No, they're actually very simple. They can be, I could do one sitting in the chair here where I just hold my finger in one spot and then I look to the right and keep my eyes on my finger, and I look to the left keeping my eyes on the finger. And if we keep doing that, it actually practices certain neural pathways that help us in balance. And there's a whole series of those that are very easy. The physical therapist teaches them to you. You do it in front of them so they make sure you have it right, and then you go home and practice.
And like everything else, if you practice, you get better. Everything from algebra 2
yes,
to this to hypnotherapy.
I assume so.
You know, Steve, I'll do a little bit of a curbside consult. Ever since I had my kids, every time I get in the car and try to read, all I want to do is throw up. And it's worse on canyons. Could this be some sort of a subtle something whacked against something else?
Yes, or you don't even have to have had it whacked. It can just be a problem within your balance system. The balance system is comprised of several components. We have feedback that comes from the joints in our body, mm-hmm. so we know where our body is. We have systems in our ears made up of little curly cues. They look like snails. And then we have the brain. And all of those systems work together along with the eyes to help us maintain our balance. So when you're reading in the car and the car's moving and you're mm-hmm. jostling about, uh-huh. you have all of those systems giving input. And if they're not functioning perfectly well, then you start feeling that dizziness or that feeling of nauseousness.
Yes. How can hypnotherapy help? First of all, we talked about how you can pick it up. Sometimes you are the first one who recognize that this could be the cause of your client's symptoms. But once someone does return with a diagnosis of traumatic brain injury, what can hypnotherapists do?
Well, there are features of traumatic brain injury, such as problems in focus, problems in concentration, fears, fear of falling, fear of going outside and dealing with other people, because the people with the traumatic brain injury have a processing problem. So it's harder for them when they're interacting, it's harder for them to walk. All of those things create a lot of fears. So if we can build confidence, if we can increase focus, concentration through hypnotherapy, that would help them quite a bit.
You talked about some of those interesting exercises you do with your eyes. Can you do them in the form of a visualization as well?
Certainly, yes, you can do it. You can do it with your eyes closed, and you can entirely take it in, with mind control. Part of the test that I didn't mention, called the computerized dynamic posturography, CDP.
Uh-huh.
It actually has people on a plate, it looks like a balance that you would weigh yourself on. And they stand on there once with their eyes open and then with their eyes closed. And we do that on a flat surface, and we do it on a surface that's not so flat.
Uh-huh.
And there's quite a bit of difference when you don't have visual input. So if you're able to have some mind control and think of where you are and focus on where you are within yourself, it helps your balance.
And does it help make those neural pathways, either repairing them or doing that workaround?
Absolutely. It will, in fact, strengthen or take an alternate path to get stronger and stronger.
What is next for traumatic brain injury? It's a very hot topic right now. We're hearing about it in the battlefield. We're hearing about it in football. What's next on the horizon with technology?
Well, we are hoping that the discovery that we've just recently had in terms of the the balance testing and the subsets that show traumatic brain injury, we're hoping to expand on that. There are new scanning equipment out there that actually are able to pick up things on a much smaller level. There's only a couple of them in the whole nation, so it's not very practical at this point, mm-hmm. but they can actually see the difference in the function of the brain that's occurring rather than the physical anatomy of the brain.
Is traumatic brain injury very different from post-traumatic stress disorder? Are they often confused? And can they're treated differently? Can you speak to that?
Yes. I'm not a psychiatrist or a psychologist, so it's hard for me to talk entirely knowledgeably on it. However, traumatic brain injury and PTSD are often comorbid situations, meaning two problems at the same time.
Yes.
Right, they go along with each other a lot. Uh-huh. As I said, the TBI causes people to not focus, causes them to be afraid of the world. They react to things differently. It starts causing emotional lability, you know, changes in your emotional status very quickly. All of these are similar in TBI and in PTSD. So the two start overlapping. Mm-hmm. And if we can start helping one of them, then we oftentimes are helping the other at the same time.
It is really, really interesting. And I want to thank you so much. You know, Dr. Grifka, everybody's going to want to know more about traumatic brain injury, the symptoms, the diagnosis, and certainly the treatment, and how hypnotherapy can help. How can people reach you?
They could reach me on the phone, 310-395-2636.
Write it down.
Which actually is 310-395-AMEN.
AMEN, what does that stand for?
It stands for A Medical Expert Network.
But I love it anyway, because it sounds like a connection with the divine. And you have a website that people can look at.
I do. It's www.amenexpert.com.
Thank you. I want to thank my very special guest, Dr. Steve Grifka, for coming in and sharing his expertise on traumatic brain injury. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Thank you.